The confidence levels was plummeted.
Remain seated, come to order.
Call your witness, please.
Call Mr. Billy Thurmond.
You administer the oath.
Yes, sir. You swear to tell the truth, all truth, and nothing but the truth in this matter pending before the court today, so help you God.
I do.
You can just leave those in case there needs to be any reference to it. Would you state your name for the record, please?
Billy Thurmond.
And what is your position with Dawson County at this time?
I'm the chairman of the Dawson County Board of Commissioners.
When did you take that position?
I was elected in 2016 and assumed the office January the 1st of 2017.
Had you had any position with the county prior to that time at some point?
Yes, sir. I had worked 37 years for the county from 1978 through December of 2015 when I retired. I had served from 2001 to 2015 as the county's emergency services director. Prior to that, from 1987 to 2001, I was the EMS director, which is just the ambulance portion of emergency services. And prior to that, from 1978 to 1987, I had done a dual role for the county where I worked at the recreation park as the athletic director as well as EMT / paramedic, because I had gotten my paramedic degree in 1985, so I had moved up in that. But yes, I worked for the county for 37 years.
During the years that you served in the fire EMS, EMA sector, what I'll just refer to generally as the public safety sector or department, did you have any involvement in budget formulation?
Yes, sir. I created a department budget from 1987 all the way through 2015.
If you would, without simply reiterating everything that Ms. Nyberg said, could you give the court a quick overview of the 2017 process for formulating the 2018 budget from the perspective of the chairman?
Yes, sir. The chairman has the responsibility of presenting a budget to the remainder of the board. This year, being the chairman, I wanted to start the process earlier, because it will give us more time to evaluate everything and to look at the budget process. I had asked Vicki, our CFO, to look at the numbers based on the history, the revenue numbers, because that's one of the first things you have to know is how much money you have. So obviously, looking at the revenue, we look at property tax, charges for service, local option sales tax, intergovernmental, fines and forfeitures, all the items that allow us to generate a revenue portion of the thing. Now, in the past, being involved in county government and being around, the revenues that have been projected were over-projected. If you looked at the history, and I went back and looked at the history, if you looked at the history of the projections of the previous chairman, they were always more than the county was taking in. So I had instructed Ms. Nykirk that I wanted to make sure that we had an attainable number that we could actually get to in revenue. Luckily for Dawson County in the past several years, Had the staff not done such a good job of managing the money that they were allocated in their budgets, we would not even have a fund balance. We would be, you know, without the ability to even look at fund balance. So that was part of what I had instructed her to do. Then, secondly, I looked at what I call a baseline budget. In other words, you have certain obligations every year that you have to pay for. Salary, benefits, the power bill, the water bill, the fuel bill, all the different things that are associated with that, you know, vehicle maintenance. I looked at all that and tried to establish what would be the total amount of money needed to cover those line items that are, you know, essentially something that you have to pay for. Well, and as has been stated many times, in 2017, the commission had commissioned a salary study that was adopted in 2017. But the whole dollar amount for that salary study for 2018, which had to be added, was $1 million. And also in 2017, the board was told by our insurance carrier that we were going to see an increase. The board did make an adjustment to where the employee paid 5% more of that particular increase, but it still resulted in the commission needing to come up with about $300,000 to cover their portion. It's an 80-20 split, is what the current is now. So looking at that, you know, we knew right off the bat that we needed $1,300,000 more dollars than what we started off with in 2017. And so we looked at, you know, the revenue, then we looked at, like I said, the baseline budgeting, and then we wanted to take a look and see, you know, if we're going to have any money left over that we could meet some of the needs of the request of all departments that had met with us and discussed their particular needs. So in the process, you know, the process basically was that we had our kickoff meeting. I spoke with the department heads and elected officials, told them to prepare their budget. And we told them to list their needs. We wanted to know what they thought they needed in their particular department. And so we had all of them to do that. And the biggest change from this year to probably previous years of the past is it was my goal, and has been my goal since I was elected chairman, to increase the communication across the board where the citizens and the commissioners as well would see the items that were placed in the budget. So that's the reason we went to advertised public meetings to where all the commissioners could be there if they so desired. And the department heads and elected officials would come before the whole board and not just the chairman. And the citizens could also come and hear the proposals that were being made by the department heads, because in essence, we all work for them, for the citizens of this county. And we even gave the citizens an opportunity to ask questions of either the board or the department head or the elected official, because we wanted to have as open a process as possible.
Are you referring to the opportunity for citizens to ask questions as something that occurred before the public hearing?
Exactly.
You can continue.
And so we met with, as Vicki, Ms. Nykirk has stated, obviously all the department heads and elected officials met with finance. Went over their budgets to discuss different things, and then we scheduled an appointment for each and every department head, every elected official, and other agency that gets revenue from Dawson County. We tried to allot enough time to give everyone the opportunity to explain their requested budget. The board had questions, if they so desired, for that department head or elected official. And then after all of those meetings that we had, which were open to the public, I then, it's my duty to present a budget to the rest of the board. I met with Vicki and I met with Natalie, and as she said, I did go line item by line item by line item in every single budget. I looked at every single one of them, and if you look at what each department head and elected official is given when they fill out the thing in CSI, they can see what they actually spent in 2015 in each line item. They can see what they actually spent in 2016 in each line item. And they can see what their actual budget was for 2017. Now, we do what's called a budget to actual process. So as I went down through each and every line item, and then I looked at the request that was made by the department head or elected official, and I looked to see what their history showed that they had spent in each one of those line items.
Let me stop you there. You say that information was shared with the department heads and officials?
Yes.
I'll show you what's marked as Exhibit R2. Is that the kind of, and take as much time as you need to look through there and see what you have, without going through those kind of forms for all the departments?
On this page here, it shows you what they spent in that actual line item in 15, and actual line item in 16, and what they were budgeted in that actual line item in 17. And then it has their requested amount for 18, and then on the other side, it has a recommended.
Does that document, R2, I believe it is?
Yes.
Does that show that sort of information associated with the historical information and the budget request as it relates to the sheriff's request?
Yes. Right. And that's everybody. Not just the sheriff, but everybody fills out the same document.
All right, but that particular one is just the sheriff's office.
That is correct. This is his admin patrol CID portion of his budget, which is listed as sheriff.
If you look through there, we see whether or not the other divisions are included in there.
Let's see. I believe they are. I believe they're all in here, but I was just looking at that first page. Yes, sheriff services. Yes, they're all here. They all are basically the same. And each one of them, they're asked to fill out what this page is, what's called a department overview, where they kind of have the opportunity to explain a little bit more in detail that maybe they couldn't put in the line item portion of it, even though there is the capability for you to type underneath each line item justification for that particular budget.
So did you receive that information as chairman? Did you receive all those budget forms?
Yes, I did.
Did you receive the sheriff's budget proposal notebook that has been introduced in evidence by the?
Yes, I did.
Let me ask you, from that point on, how did you go about formulating your proposal for the budget?
Well, as I said, I went down through each and every budget, line item by line item, and knowing what we had already committed to, the amount of money that we were going to have to have, I created a budget that came out to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $25 million and some odd thousand dollars, but we only had $23 million and something thousand dollars in potential revenue. I believe it was revenue piece of it was $23,960,739, and the expenditure side of it was $25,516,312. Knowing that by law we have to have a balanced budget, then we dipped into our fund balance to balance that budget. And so we didn't have, you know, really any extra money once you kind of got past the baseline. Now, we did raise some generalized, you know, line items in some of the budgets. There were some reduction in some of the line items in some of the budgets based on the history. I know there's been talk about the fuel budget for the sheriff. Obviously, we did cut that because history showed that they had spent no more than $130-something thousand on an average for the last 2 years. And the fact that fuel had not gone up drastically, we did lower that to $140,000.
And is that an approach you took with respect to other departments?
I did that as well with the fire department, with public works, all that had fuel, everyone's fuel budget was cut. And we did that same approach regardless of the line item. Looking at the history, looking at the request, looking at the justification that was attached to that request to make that determination. So there were line items that got raised based on good justification that they needed more money in that particular line item. And then we came to that final dollar figure. Well, I think mine might have been a little bit less than that overall, because I think the other board members added some to that at the very end. But the final budget wound up being $25,516,312, which required the use of fund balance to balance that particular budget.
Is that a general fund balance, a general fund budget?
That's a general fund budget. That's the day-to-day operating budget for all the department heads and the elected officials.
Does not include SPLOSH.
Does not include SPLOSH. Those are all different funds. You have, the total overall county budget that you add in all the other funds was $38,622,699 was the total budget. That includes the general fund, E911, fuel and fleet, date fund, jail fund, LBAP fund, law library, family connection, inmate welfare, confiscated assets, grant fund, hotel motel tax, SPLOSH 6, capital projects, solid waste, DCAR GIS, inmate escrow, to get to that total $38,600-something number.
When you made your chairman's proposal of the budget on August 10th, did you include a written budget document as well as the PowerPoint that Mr. Holmes has already introduced as an exhibit?
I believe there were, I think I have it here, let's see. That was part of the, I don't know if that was part of the PowerPoint or not. Can't remember. I'm not sure if I actually had that as part of my PowerPoint, but it was on the county's website and part of available for people to look at.
Right. But you did also do the PowerPoint.
Yes, there was a PowerPoint on the presentation that I was presenting to my fellow commissioners and to the staff. Because at that meeting, I had asked either the department head or elected official or someone from their department to actually come to that presentation. And I think most people were represented at that presentation. Because at that time, knowing that I wasn't going to be recommending any new personnel at that particular time, and that we didn't have a lot of excess revenue available to us that was, we looked at what we had the ability to use in the fund balance and trying to stay within the county policy of maintaining a 15-25% fund balance based on, just the need to have emergency funds available, which we've used on numerous occasions for different things. We want to be prepared for that. So one of them comes, I'd like to give them a personal explanation of why there wasn't a lot extra presented in this budget. So at that meeting, I told them that we would take a serious look at the end of 2017 to see if revenue had actually exceeded what was proposed in 2017. And if there was, I had asked all of them to provide me with their top three priorities so that the board in the first quarter of 2018 could take a look at it if there was extra revenue and try to fix some of their needs. And we would try to knock those off on a quarterly basis if additional revenue came in. Another thing that I wanted them to know is that the board looked at, is looking, currently still looking at ways to generate other revenue. We're doing a complete countywide property tax reevaluation. It's going to take a couple of years for that process to go through. Trying to generate more revenue. We're looking at the re-implementation of impact fees, trying to generate more capital revenue so that we're able to meet the growing demands of each department. We were looking at, T-Splosh, which is a way for us to do some of our road maintenance. So all the available things that we could come up with, we're looking at trying to provide an opportunity to generate more revenue. Because the board realizes that every department has needs. And unfortunately, over the past several years in the downturn in the economy, the can has got kicked down the road on a lot of things. First and foremost was being the employees. Coming into this job, the department heads and elected officials, I believe, were all in agreement that the number one problem that they had was maintaining a staffing level, trying to have enough staff to do their day-to-day operations. So the board looked at that, and the board decided that, you know, we need to take and try to at least keep the people we already had before we started adding people. So, and hence the finalization of the salary study that had been started in 2016. The board adopted that, and it went into effect in April. And as we said before, that's $1 million for the whole year. It was 700 or 600 something thousand for the remainder of 17, but it had to be added into 2018. So the county has a lot of issues when it comes to funding that we're looking at. Obviously, employee retention was very important to all the department heads and elected officials, was very important to the board. So we tried to knock off the biggest problem that the department heads and elected officials told us, and being a former department head, I was very aware of that, of that being a problem. And so we tried to fix that first. And so, doing that, obviously, you have to have more revenue because it's a forever cost. It goes over from year to year to year. And you will see that in an effort to try to even maintain that, in the presentation that I made, I had included a 2% increase that the remainder of the board took out. But when we had the salary study done, the gentleman that did it for us, you know, we'd had, they looked at the last 5 years of the turnover, and we'd had 105% turnover ratio. The gentleman stated that that was the worst one that he'd ever seen in his 30 years of doing salary studies. So his recommendation was that we adopt the salary study and continue to follow up on it so that we didn't get back into that same problem again. So the goal was obviously to fix that problem, so that's what we tried to do. And like I say, with that, we had to come up with that money in the 2018 budget as well.
So did the sheriff's office get any part of the increase that resulted in 2017 from the salary study implementation?
Yes, all departments got an increase from the salary study.
Is the intention, if there should be a 2% increase, assuming funds are available sometime this current year, that the sheriff's office would get, his staff would get the benefit of that 2% increase as well?
All county employees would.
In looking at those, as you put it, forever costs, one of the things that has been mentioned in the testimony here has been the 9 additional folks in fire EMS that were added at some point, essentially around the time the budget was approved this past year. How did you approach doing that, given that forever cost idea?
Well, Chief Swofford had presented to the board earlier the application for the SAFER grant. And the board at that particular time had authorized him to go ahead and apply for that grant. That was about the fourth or fifth year, I guess, that the Emergency Services Department had put in for that grant. We were lucky enough, or the county was lucky enough, and our citizens were lucky enough for that grant to be awarded. It was a 75% federally funded, 25% match grant. The board looked at that and they decided that, you know, when you get 75% of free money, then you should take that. And one of the things that I had told all of our department heads and elected officials in my initial meeting I had with them was to look heavily at grants. And if they could find a grant that was, you know, 50% paid for by federal money, then to by all means, bring that before the board and we would do what we could to make sure that we could help them get that. Those are, I mean, to me, that's just good use of taxpayers' money to get something you actually need and only have to pay 25% of the cost. And the board looked at it the same way.
Well, what happens at the end of the grant, the SAFER grant time, with those 9 people that were hired?
They were told on the hiring that this was only a 3-year guarantee of a job, based on the fact that it is a 3-year grant. And they were told when they were hired that hopefully the board and the county finances would be good enough for them to be continued to work, but there was no guarantee to them that they would have a job beyond the 3-year period of the grant.
Following your proposal presentation back in August, were you involved in the public meetings and hearings that took place about the budget?
Yes, I believe I was at all of them but one.
At the ones that you were at, these are public hearings, is that right?
That's correct.
In public hearings on the budget of that sort, are members of the staff and elected officials, such as the sheriff, allowed to attend and participate and make comments?
Absolutely. At a public hearing, anyone can make a comment. It doesn't have to be an elected official or a staff, it can be the public.
Did the sheriff avail himself of those opportunities?
He did.
On more than one occasion?
Yes, on more than one occasion.
Was his attorney allowed to speak on his behalf as well?
He was.
On more than one occasion?
Yes.
Did he submit correspondence to you, his attorney?
You talking about verbal?
Regarding the budget.
Yes, yes. We discussed it.
And there was discussion in the testimony earlier about, and in reference to a letter that was attached to from the attorney to the board that was attached, a copy of it, to the petition with respect to a hearing that was held, I believe it was August 17th, maybe, where there was not advertising and notice sufficient to count that as the public hearing that's required by statute. You remember hearing that testimony?
I am familiar, and I also received that letter.
All right. Was a hearing held that did satisfy those requirements?
Yes. More than one.
Okay. And at the end of the sequence of hearings, did you schedule any other meetings or hearings where the sheriff could have further input?
Yes, we had a special call meeting to discuss the sheriff's budget and anyone else that wanted to come.
Well, did that meeting primarily focus on the sheriff's budget?
It did.
Were the members of the commission allowed to ask questions of the sheriff?
They were.
did the meeting center on questions about Pyrex glassware acquisition of some kind?
There were some questions in reference to that, but that was not the center of the meeting, no.
Were similar questions that have been discussed the focus of that meeting?
Yes, it was focused on the budget.
Okay. Budget overall?
Yeah, the 2018 overall budget, yes. The board asked questions because they had some concerns. And so, obviously, that's their job, is to ask questions if they have concern. But the meeting was centered around the 2018 budget. There were questions asked about 17's budget by the board members that they had some concerns with as they were trying to tabulate what they were going to do in 2018.
Were the sheriff and his staff, his attorney, allowed to speak at that meeting?
They were.
Were they limited at any of these meetings as to how much input they could give or what they were allowed to talk about?
No limitation.
Was their time limited? Were they ever cut off?
No.
Because of time?
No.
Once the board establishes a budget, as you now have done for fiscal year 2018, can the board amend that budget?
Yes, they have the power to amend that, and that was what basically I wanted all the department heads and elected officials to know, that if we generated more revenue, that we would amend the budget, and we wouldn't do as they had done in the past, to where it was a whole nother 12 months before they were willing to look at some of the needs. So that's the reason I had asked for the top three priorities from each and every department and each and every elected official.
Can the budget be amended up or down?
Yes.
Is that limited to any particular department or office?
No. I mean, a good example of that would be back in the downturn of the economy. Every department's budget was amended downward due to the fact that revenues decreased quickly and rapidly. During that time frame, each and every department head was asked to lower their budget by 10% in the first round, and then came back and were asked to lower it another 5% in the second round to be able to stay within the monies that were actually coming in. So yes, and many years the budget has been amended up. 2017, we amended it up when we did the salary study. As has been stated, we amended it up when we added some people to the planning department. So yes, it can be amended, at the discretion of the board.
Why would you amend the budget to allow an increase in staffing in the planning and development department and not other departments?
Well, the planning department, they, obviously is the department that sees the growth first when it comes to housing permits, it comes to permits in reference to commercial. We've seen an increase in their inspections, so we approved, I believe it was another inspector, and we approved another person to help them in the office.
How did that affect, or take into account the bottom line on revenues and expenditures that relate to planning and development?
It increased their budget in reference to the expenditure side of it, yes. One thing about planning and zoning, too, with the increase in the permitting and stuff like that, their revenue side also increased. Planning and development is probably the only department in the county that's almost self-sufficient. In other words, their cost to the taxpayer, they generate enough revenue to almost cover all of that.
Based on what kind of revenue?
They get permit fees, inspection fees. So when the developer comes and brings plans, they, plan reviews and different things like that that they actually charge for and generate revenue.
Are they involved in issuing the licenses and permits?
Yes, they issue all the business licenses and permits for the county.
Does that likewise derive revenue for the county?
Yeah, there's a business license permit, I mean fee, and of course there's permit fee.
How about alcohol licenses?
They do those as well.
Did the sheriff office budget for 2018 increase overall as compared with the 2017 budget?
Yes. Even after the amendment.
Even considering the amendment that's been discussed?
Yes, it did increase.
The salary adjustment amendment?
Primarily, as it's been stated, it would be in salary and benefits, primarily, yes. But it did increase, as everybody's did after the amendment. Everybody's in 18 increased, because if you just looked at the basic, in 2017, when we did the salary study increase, that began in April. So you had the first 3 months that had to be added into 18. So everybody, every single department in the county that the county pays somebody in, saw an increase in their 2018 salary budget, has that even after the amendment in 2017. Every single department saw that.
So the sheriff's general fund budget from 2017 to 2018 increased?
Yes.
How about the SPLOST appropriation for the sheriff's office?
Yes, I believe it went from $500,000 to $600,000. And he, and in reference to the entire budget, if you look down through, you know, there were some line items that went down based on history. There were some line items that went up based on justification. There were some line items that stayed the same as they were in 2017. But that was part of the process of me going down every single budget line item by line item before I made my proposal.
Did the final approved budget parallel the proposed budget that you had submitted earlier exactly, or were there changes made to it?
There were changes made to it. It wasn't exact.
How did those changes come about?
Well, I present my budget to the entire board and to the citizens in a meeting, and then the commission takes that, and then they come back. If they want to make changes to that proposal, then they present those, then those changes are presented, and it's up to the board if they decide they're going to vote for those changes or they're going to go with what I proposed.
In the particular case of the 2018 budget, what is your understanding of how the changes that were made from your proposal to the final approved budget, how and why those occurred?
Well, each board member obviously had the proposal that I had. Department heads and elected officials could speak to any commissioner that they so desired to ask for a change to what I had proposed, if that was their desire to do so. Then that board member, you know, would make that recommendation, and then they were all compiled in Vicki's office. They were compiled by her once each board member, you know, might say, well, you know, like for example, I don't remember which one it was, but one of them wanted to take out the $200,000+ that I had appropriated for the 2% salary increase.
Was that in fact eliminated?
It was.
Will it be potentially reconsidered in light of what you were saying earlier?
Yes, and the board had agreed that if the revenues picked up so that we wouldn't start back down that same trail of not paying our personnel what they're entitled to, what they should be getting based on the salary study, that they would take a relook at that in the first quarter of 2018, and if the revenues increased, as we all hope that they would, then we would take a relook at that and put that on an agenda for a vote.
You've indicated that you, to some extent, had to utilize existing fund balance of the general fund in order to make your $25 million or so overall budget. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Why do you even have a fund balance?
Well, fund balance is obviously to make up the deficiencies that you may have in a particular budget. It also is sound financial practice to have money for unexpected emergencies that might come up. Some examples would be like in 2014 when we had the winter storm, the county had to upfront $1 million+ to have the cleanup done for that storm. Now we got most of that back over 2 years later from FEMA and GEMA due to good work by the staff and documentation after the federal disaster that was declared. We've had other situations where we had a fire truck that was wrecked, so we needed, you know, $350,000-$400,000 to replace that, so that we could have, you know, a fire truck at that particular station because we don't have any spares. There's been other instances, where fund balance is, used, like when, we did that 2017 in the planning department. It's there for the board to use when they are presented with a need that they feel that's important enough to get into the fund balance. But they also realize that it's important that we stay within that 15% to 25% parameter for those, emergency situations. Another example would be, God forbid we had a murder case where we had two or three defendants and we had to pay for their attorney. And so, you have to be, as a county, you have to be prepared for what you don't know might come and need some funding for that, or you wind up doing like Mrs. Nykirk said, you get into what's called the TANs, and you have to go borrow money against your property tax that you're going to collect for the next year. Well, that's a, as everyone here would know, that's a process that you're not going to win with, because you're spending money in a year that should be used in the next year. And so it's important to have the ability to have some fund balance.
So if you were to do a tax anticipation note, a TAN, to finance a given year's budget at a given point in the year, how would you repay it?
You have to pay it with the tax collections of that particular year before, and which means you would automatically be that many dollars behind to begin with. It's not a long-term loan, it's a same-year loan.
Well, going back to the fund balance idea, you say you mentioned the same range of 15% to 25% of the overall budget. Where do you stand at this point in terms of the county's general fund balance in terms of that percentage range?
With what, if I'm correct, I believe that with what's been proposed for usage in 17, which we're still getting all those final numbers in that, and what's been proposed in 2018 usage, we'll be right at 15%. If that all gets used. Now, hopefully that will not be the case to where all of that will get used.
So there's just no way of knowing?
You don't know
until you get the collection.
Until the numbers come in, yeah. I mean, all these things are projections. The revenue's a projection. Your expenditures are not a projection. They're pretty well, but luckily, as I said before, the department heads and elected officials in the past years have done a really good job of managing their budgets, allowing us to have a fund balance. Otherwise, we wouldn't have one.
Well, I apologize if I've already asked this, but in terms of amendments to a budget during the year, Ms. Nykirk was asked whether the $260,000 that was included in the sheriff's budget is a capital item to cover half of the estimated cost of the CAD system could be taken away. You recall that?
Yes.
Is it your understanding that that could be taken away?
The board does have the authority of that, but I see no reason why that would be done.
Could the board, again, reduce the budget as to other items in the general fund for the sheriff or anybody else, any other departments or officials, if it saw reason to do so?
Well, it, you know, as was in the downturn of the economy, if that happened again in 2018, which it doesn't look that way, we would have to go to all the department heads and elected officials and ask them to cut a percentage so that we could maintain, you know, a balanced budget. Now, that would be up to, as before, when they did it before, they left that discretion of what they were going to cut up to the department head or the elected official. The board did not determine what the cut would be, no.
You mentioned that when the downturn occurred, department heads and officials were asked to cut 10%?
10%. First time.
First time. Was there another cut?
There was, 5%.
And how was that 10 and 5% set of cuts implemented?
Well, it was basically they asked the department heads and the elected officials to look at their budget and to, like I say, cut those, that percentage. And so basically, as a department head at that particular time, I went through my budget line item by line item, looking at what I thought that we could, you know, cut back on. We had a couple of open positions at that particular time that we didn't fill. There were some other things that we, in some of the line items, like small equipment that we didn't buy that particular year because, you know, certain things still had to be paid, like the power bill and the, you know, water bill and all that. I mean, you didn't want to get your power cut off, so you had to continue to pay those. But you looked at basically the line items that you could do without. You may have wanted it, but you could do without.
Could the line items in question include staff positions?
Yes, and like I said, we had two positions that were funded that were current, that at that particular time we didn't have anybody in, so we used that as part of our 10%.
To your knowledge, did former Sheriff Carlisle cut or freeze positions in making those adjustments?
I can't say 100%, but I believe he did.
So there are some frozen positions in the sheriff's office at this point?
I believe there are probably in most of, not all of the departments, but a lot of the departments have frozen positions, correct? Yes. I think there's still like, I think there's 29 still that are frozen countywide, I believe.
In the case of the constitutional elected county officials, such as the sheriff, the tax commissioner, the probate judge, clerk of court, do they have the flexibility to, whether it's termed a frozen position or a layoff, whatever may have been the nature of the lack of that staff position being filled in the first place or kept filled, do they have the discretion within the available funds in their budget to put positions back in and not spend that money on something else?
They do. That's not the same discretion that department heads have, though. The elected officials do.
Going back to the amendments to the budget for reduction purposes, particularly the CAD capital improvement element of $260,000 in the sheriff's budget, Are there any plans to make such reductions? Not limited just to that, but to any other reductions?
No.
Do you have plans to do that?
No, not at this time unless there's a major change in the economy. And right now, the economy's looking pretty good, so. We're actually hoping that we can do it, go the other way, where we can look at some of the things that we didn't fund and hopefully be able to fund some of them.
Does the Board of Commissioners have the ability or authority to control how Sheriff spends his budget money that's available within the general fund portion of his budget?
No.
Has the Board of Commissioners made any effort to control his discretion in that regard?
Not to my knowledge.
Does the sheriff have the autonomy to hire and fire and promote and assign duties as he deems appropriate?
Yes, he's elected just like I am. Yes, he has total control of the sheriff's department.
Does he have to follow the Dawson County policies and guidelines regarding finance and personnel?
No, he does not.
If he can do whatever he wants then in terms of those things, what is the effect of your assigning the budget process dollars to those particular categories and line items?
Well, I would think that it helps him as well as helps finance, as finance tries to pay the bills that are generated through the sheriff's department. That also helps him manage the money that he has available to him, that he knows that he has, you know, this much money left in a particular account, you know, so that he can pay the things that he has to pay, you know, that he knows he wants to pay, his salaries and his benefits and the power bill and the water bill. But he has discretion to move that money around any way that he so desires to do.
Did the board, including yourself, at any point refuse to meet with the sheriff about his budget requests or the justification for him for 2018?
I can only speak for me, but I have never refused to meet with anyone.
Have you, in fact, met with him at any point about budget or finance, any of those matters?
Sheriff and I did meet. We had a, basically it was me and you, I think, one time about the budget we talked about.
And you're directed at the sheriff when you said.
Yeah, the sheriff and I met, yes.
And has, in fact, the board met with the sheriff and at times his staff to discuss the budget and hear presentations from him in terms of the sort of meetings we've been talking about?
Yes. I know a couple of the board members, Commissioner Gaines and Commissioner Nix, met with him. The way it's set up, only outside of a public meeting, only two commissioners can be together at the same time and discuss, you know, county business. So they met with him, yes, in that. And then, of course, at all the other meetings or public meetings that we had and hearings that we had, obviously, you know, the sheriff was afforded the opportunity to come, he did, and speak and talk about his particular budget and his particular needs.
Let me kind of get to the point where I can cut to the chase and just ask this. Why didn't the Board of Commissioners fund all of the requested items that the sheriff put in his 2018 fiscal year budget proposal?
There wasn't enough revenue, even with the use of fund balance to fund. The board looks at the entirety of the county when we're doing a budget and trying to be as fair as possible across the board, come up with a budget. And in this particular year, in 2018, with the additions that had already been approved by the board in 17, basically every budget wound up being what I would call status quo. In other words, not much change other than the things that we were already obligated to pay for. And in my presentation, as you will see, there was, you know, at that particular time, no positions for any department. And then there were some changes made to that as we found out about the grant, and then obviously the board saw fit that there was a need for another school resource officer, and there was already a commitment from the school board to fund half of that. And so they saw fit that for the safety of our children that go to the school, that they wanted to put that back in the budget.
When you say the grant, are you referring to the safer grant?
I am.
Fire officers?
I am. Had they not got that grant, they would not have gotten anyone.
If you wanted to give more to the sheriff or anybody else in terms of allocation for expenditures on the general fund, would you have any way to come up with it that the money fund those additional appropriations that you can think of other than, for example, raising the millage rate or further invading the general fund fund balance?
No. The millage rate would be...
Or taking away from some other place in the budget if there's not enough of an increase in the course of the year to cover this.
No, because, you know, the sheriff as well as our other elected officials and department heads operate their budgets, as a pretty much at a, I would say, call it a get by level. I mean, we've got, you know, a lot of departments that need help. That's one of the reasons that the board is looking at other mechanisms of generating more revenue. The board answers to the public, obviously, and there is no real desire out there amongst the public to see their millage rate increase. But in discussions with the board members individually, you know, I've said that, you know, if the things that we have put in place don't work, we're going to have to look at a potential millage rate increase, because unfortunately, from the downturn in the economy, and we still have, as has been mentioned, we still haven't got back to where we were in property tax. We've seen increases in sales tax. Those increases on a year basis don't match up to what we've still not regained in property tax. We're actually generating budgets today that were less than the budgets of 2008-2009. So, and those budgets were being funded by revenue that was being generated. So we're still trying to get back and create ways to generate more revenue so that we can meet the needs of not only the sheriff, but all the departments and all the elected officials. Because as we stated, and I think all the board members stated in the meetings publicly, that they knew they needed it. And so we want to, get to that point. I think our request, I don't remember exactly what it was, but if you looked at the request for the entire county that the board had to look at, it was like an additional $2.7 million of additional requests countywide. Well, that equates to about two point something mills of property tax. So,
had it been approved
to do everything that was asked for, we'd had to raise the millage rate by 2.7 mils. That's not a popular move amongst the constituents. The board has tough decisions that they have to make when it comes to that, but, you know, it may require, if things don't change, and the even though the economy's doing better, and these things that we put into place don't generate the revenue we need, then we may have to look at raising the millage rate. And those are things that we've discussed individually and that I have personally told each and every board member that we may have to do. I think it's all about explanation to the public and letting them know where we are. And I have tried to do that throughout the first year that I've been in office, is try to explain to everyone where we really stand.
Thank you, sir. Witnesses, would you?
Thank you.
How long do you think you'd be across?
Half hour or so, good.
Let's take a 10-minute recess before we do that. We'll take 10 minutes and then recommence.
Let's go.
Yeah, I know. We were just saying that.